G'day. This part had me really worried because of its nature. I thought it was going to chatter, but I do seem to have managed to get round that. This is the part. It's a velocity stack, and you can see it gets very thin at the end. That's just under a millimeter of wall there. This is my drill, and you can see the edge has been backed off. That's what we used to do with drills for brass, to stop them grabbing. But in this case, if I don't do that, when the drill's breaking through, it stops the lathe. And it's 2 horsepower lathe. It's not nice to go stopping it like that. So I tend to have all my big drills backed off like that so that they don't grab. The drill's being held in the cast iron block that attaches to the carriage, the cross slide rather, after the compound slide and tool post have been removed. Here you'll see I stick the end of the chuck key in the part because it's too darn hot to hold. There's the block I was talking about. You can see that it's held in with cap screws and some dowels. The dowel's got the nut on it. And the large slot is for a big boring bar to go in there. And that works quite well too. Yes, that's a result of drilling a few of those blanks. And it certainly adds up. It's quite a big bucket on my vacuum cleaner. After drilling them, I take them to put them back into the lathe to be squared up on the ends and turned a bit so that I've got a good surface to grab them with in the soft jaws in the CNC lathe. This is the, had to do this in 2 operations. And I had to just bore them out first. The boring bar is so big that there was no way that I could get it to rotate in my turret without my turret. Well, turret just couldn't handle it. You can see it's quite big. And in fact, later you'll see the thing deflecting. And it's only held in by a little M4 screw, and I think that's possibly where the deflection was coming from. But you can see it's a big lump to have on a little turret like that, which is basically for holding 10x10 shank tools. I could only think of doing this way is actually boring something out to 59, which is what I want the jaws to be, because when you're using manual in the Hercus, you really can't tell it to go to any particular part, any particular place or distance. You can only take it there manually. Now what I did was I took the X figure that you see there, and then when I was doing the jaws, I took the diameter out to that 117.56. And that way I was able to know that I was going to get 59, because I don't know how you'd measure a diameter between 3 jaws. There you can see I'm gripping on about 5 millimeters of stock. I did see a Hass video on YouTube that suggested you needed to hang on to a third of your stock. Yes, I think that's when you've got a fair bit more horsepower available than I have here. You see we're drawing 4 amps using a boring bar. And if you watch carefully, you will see that boring bar dive down a bit when the actual cut comes on. You can actually see it as the cuts get shorter. You can actually see it as it bounces back up too. And that's just using a canned cycle for boring from within the Hercus software. They're quite good because they allow you to change the feed and change the depth of cut all within one line, basically. Works quite well. Okay, yes, so let's get this finished off. I've seen enough of the boring bar. There we go. I was making 20 of these things for them to be used as prototypes in the bikes to see if there was any performance gain either on track or on the dyno. You can see the first idea I had was to thin it all down, but then that left that bit that's within the circle to be removed, and I really wasn't confident that would happen without the thing chattering and things getting nasty, so I went with the second design, which you can see here on the simulation. Each line that tool is following, I had actually drawn in CAD and put in previously to do that bit of turning. That's the left hand tool cleaning it all up, so that bit's finished now. Then we go back in with a right hand turning tool, which has only a 0.2 radius to try and keep the chattering down. I don't know if it would have chattered, I just didn't see any point in not doing all I could in the first instance to try and get the thing to work properly. They're the tools that I decided I would use, including that little parting tool, but when I went to set it up, it really looked as though I was going to have some difficulty with the end of the trumpet not clearing the housing of the turret. So I tried using that other one, but it's not nearly as sharp as the one I was intending to use. It has a tip like that, an insert like that. And you can see it's not really sharp when you compare it with that one, which is aggressively sharp. So these are normally held in with a cam that goes up against that stop you can see. It wasn't reaching, so I made a little piece, but that ended up with it sticking out too far. I found one, I've actually found three of those. So I used that one and just went with it as it was. I thought it would clear. I show this part of the turning a few times in this video, so and for good reason, because it shows different things, but where I can I've sped it up so that don't all die of boredom. Now you can see this swarf is building up here rather badly. That is a 0.08 of a millimeter per revolution feed. And it's obviously not enough. And I couldn't get it away because I couldn't get to the left hand side of the turret. For some reason, someone had put a tripod and camera in the way. But that swarf, that tangle there, actually renders this part useless. Created a sharp edge where it finished off instead of the chamfer that it should have been. And that's just the... Yeah, that was a nice surprise. No parting tool. So I had to do it manually. And when you do manual with the Hercus, as I said, you can't send it to any particular place. It's just like having a manual lathe, but you use an electric button to actually move the thing. You got no idea where you are or anything, so. Anyway, that parted off. Now, you can see here that nasty line that's created by that tangled mess. Under the microscope, you can see on the left-hand side, it's really jagged. Instead of blending into the chamfer, it just made that mess. And on this particular one anyway, it was the blank was too long. I found another one like that. There were two in total. They were half a millimeter too long. So, yeah, they just made a mess of that too. But when I came to the other one, I was able to correct the offsets and do get it right. You see, the arc was actually starting beyond the part, but the part was just too long for it to blend in nicely. Here we go again, I've sped it up already. It's doing 2000 RPM now. First one was doing 2500. Right, now I'm sorry you can hardly see the end of the insert here, but I think you can get the impression that the chips are coming away better. That's going from 0.08 to 0.1 millimeters of feed per revolution. It was just enough to get the swarf to break off nicely. or not become a tangled mess anyway. So that tool behaved as it should have. This is the 0.2 nose radius tool, and it's not chattering. I was really quite pleased that I'd thought it through and used what I thought were the best possible option. Yeah, no parting tool again. That I'd thought it through and used what I thought was the best possible option to get it to work. Okay, we're doing it again now. A little bit faster even. You can see a bit more of the tool this time. You see the chips are breaking. That's the only left-handed tool I have. It's one I got when I originally got this, when I bought this lathe back in 2005. I was going to buy a shank for the 35 degree inserts, but it was going to take a week to get here and didn't want to wait. But that one's doing the job, so that was pleasant. I didn't have to spend money on a new tool. I think this speeds up again in a minute. There we go. And then back down to normal replay speed. And I have to admit, I'm pleased with what we did there. Hey, look, a parting tool. It's always nice when a plan comes together. Yeah, and it wasn't meant to drop off. There's some weights for you to have a look at. The original blank is 460 grams and the final part is 46 grams. That's a lot of swarf. I ended up using two sprays, one for the left-handed tool and the other one for the normal right-handed tools. This is what the product looked like. And you can see there's no chatter on that thin wall section. Now if you hang around a bit, you'll see me trying to get the part to not drop off. The thing is, if you don't remove enough material, when you're hitting it, you can actually pull it out the jaws, which means you can't really part the darn thing off anyway. So that one, I mean, there's a number of these shots and I'm adjusting the tool in the X to go in a little bit further each time. But just took a while to get it right. So they're starting to come off a little better. Couple of sharp wraps and it's off. Typical, last one, and that's it. Thank you for watching.